Welcome to the Brute Strength Podcast, bringing you worldwide experts from all areas of health and fitness. We cover training, nutrition, coaching, and mindset. Welcome your host, strength and conditioning coach, 2012 and 2013 CrossFit Games champ, Michael Cashew. Mind, body, brute.
What's up? Welcome back. My name is Mike Cashew, and you're listening to the Brute Strength Podcast. This week's guest is Ryan Flaherty. Ryan is on the Nike training team, and he works with literally the biggest athletes on the planet, like Serena Williams, Russell Wilson, Kobe Bryant. He works with, I think he told me, 18 of the 32 quarterbacks in the NFL, and he's one of the most sought-after combine coaches in the world. He's known as the savant of speed. And so obviously one of the biggest topics we go into on the show is how he builds speed in athletes. But we start out talking about some of the work that he's doing with the founder of HeadSpace and how they're teaching NFL players how to focus more and how to cultivate a better mindset. We talk about a bet that he made with Johnny Manziel as he trained him for the combine. We talk a lot about what he calls the force number and how he can predict anyone's 40-yard dash, concentric-only training for speed development. And we spend the majority of the show talking about how he builds speed and what makes his training programs a little bit different. And whether or not you're interested in building speed, the way that he thinks about programming is a paradigm shift for most people who are very tactic or tool driven. This will give you a really good perspective on how to change your programming or your coaching or both. Finally, we talk about how to prevent injury as you get older when playing sports like flag football, soccer, basketball, etc. And then we talk about his experience in CrossFit. He started training a couple of the Nike-sponsored CrossFit athletes. There are only a handful of those in existence, so I'm sure you can guess who those are. And he wanted to know for himself what the demands of CrossFit were, so he did it for a while. And we just talked about his experience, and I got his suggestions for how we can make changes in CrossFit gyms to treat our members better. This was a real treat for me. I really nerded out more than I have in a really long time. And it's because Ryan has this ability to synthesize and talk about very, very high level, biomechanics and exercise science concepts and distill it down for the layman like myself. So I know you're going to love this one as well. Before we get started, if you haven't done so already, we've got something relatively new on the site for you. It is a copy of our 5 most downloaded podcast. It's a free PDF. And on the PDF are the 5 most downloaded shows and the biggest takeaways from each. So very tactical, practical things that you can go and implement into your life, into your training, et cetera, immediately. And you can get access to that at brutestrengthtraining.com/top5. brutestrengthtraining.com/top5. Enjoy the show. Ryan, what's up, brother? Thank you for making some time for me today, man.
My pleasure, man. Thanks for having me.
So I want to start with, I was looking through your Instagram feed, kind of doing some research on you a few days ago, and I saw you make a post about doing some work with Andy, I think it's Puttycomb, that is the founders of HeadSpace. And I've recommended HeadSpace to at least 1,000 people by now. And so it really made me stop and look. What kind of work have you done with Andy? What were y'all doing at Nike together?
Yeah, so Nike has established a big partnership with HeadSpace over the past, I would say, like year and a half. And, you know, initially the partnership was going to just start out where we were going to partner on some content creation together. They do some Nike has two digital apps, one being the Nike Training Club, which is like a, you know, fitness kind of training app. Another one is NRC, which is the Nike Run Club, which is kind of like a, you know, run tracker, GPS tracker. And hey, I have workouts in there, all that other stuff. And we started out where he was doing a lot of audio guided runs, kind of like, you know, mindful running and talking through, you know, having you think through different, you know, meditation, drills or focus drills to kind of as you run that we were creating together. But one of the big things that came to light was, you know, how can we further build the, you know, the relationship between Headspace and Nike with our athletes? And so he and I met about a year ago, and we started talking through kind of what athletes we think could we connect him with that may see a ton of benefit in it. You know, I think today the predominant the psychology and mindset training that goes on in most American sports is sports psychology, which is very much based on positive thinking. Mm-hmm. And you know, one of the difficult things with positive thinking that I find with athletes, and what I've seen over the years of working with athletes, is that with positive, there's always a negative, right? You can't have positive without negative. There's a yin and a yang there. Right. And I think when you think about that, so let's say an NFL quarterback that I work with, you know, a good game is 60% completion rate, you know, a couple touchdowns, maybe, you know, one or two turnovers, hopefully none, but you're going to have some turnovers. You're going to only complete 60% of your balls, right, on a great day. So 40% of the time, it's a bad play. How does an athlete then deal with that negativity if all they're taught is positive thinking? And I think when you look at a lot of athletes and a lot of quarterbacks specifically, is they, what separates the great ones from the good ones is that mindset, that ability to like go from, you know, a negative play to the next play, trying to turn that back into a positive and not letting that momentum take you into a place that leads to, you know, you to lose the game or to have a lot of bad stuff then happen. You see a lot of times the momentum shift right in a game, and all of a sudden it's like they can't do anything right. The other team can't do anything wrong. And what creates that shift? And a lot of it is just how you think about it, how you move from one thing to the next, having a short-term memory that way. And so what Andy brings is, which is really interesting, and you know, it doesn't work for everybody, but it does work for a lot of people, is that you don't look at any one event in a game as negative or positive. You just look at it as it is. So like if I throw an interception and it gets returned for a touchdown, all it is I threw an interception. It just is what it is. It's just an interception. It's not, I don't attach too much, you know, emotion and positive or negative to that event.
Good or bad.
Exactly. And I think that's the biggest thing that athletes do, is they attach so much good to positive to good things that when a bad thing happens, they don't know how to deal with it because it almost becomes overwhelming. Mm-hmm. And I think when you look back, you know, look at Tom Brady in the Super Bowl when they're down 28-3, every other quarterback in the league loses that game. He doesn't, because he has ability to look at it as, okay, this is just where we are. There's never anything that's too big or too small for him. The next moment just becomes, he just stays in the present so well that I think it's something that a lot of athletes can learn from. And so, and I started kind of connecting Andy with a lot of the quarterbacks I work with. So I work with, I think now it's 19 of the 32 starting quarterbacks in the NFL that I train. And,
let's highlight that. 19 of the best, of the 32 best football players on the planet.
Yeah,
I don't want people to overlook that.
Yeah, no, it's pretty cool. It's you know, and working with all of them, what I've learned is that there's certain things that elevate, that becomes a, you know, a common trait amongst all of them. And one of them is that they all treat their mind as another muscle. They train it just as much as they do anything else. And so I've been connecting Andy with a lot of them, because not very few of them have been connecting strongly with like the sports psychology realm with positive thinking. And they've all struggled with it. So Andy's been doing some work with them, and it's very simple stuff. Like he does this focus drill where he has them stand, and it's basically during the national anthem. So when the national anthem is going on and you know, you're obviously paying respect to the country and whatnot, that there's a 2-minute kind of drill that he has them do at that moment, which allows them to focus in. They kind of take in the moment, the environment. Then they like focus in on something really, really small, like an opposing player's number and like the stitching on that number across the field. They stare at that, and then they look, and then they open back up to the broader kind of moment, and they focus in on that, on the stitching on that number across the field again. And they keep doing that for 2 minutes. And then after the end of it, it's weird. And this drill is actually in the Headspace app. But you kind of feel like all of a sudden like really zoned in, and it's a drill that he does with them to teach them that at any moment in the game, when you're like kind of felt like you're taken out of that focus, to get it back in there, he has a drill for that. And these little drills kind of really help a lot of the quarterbacks that work with him to kind of really hone in and focus in a way that they haven't been able to do before, and they haven't been taught before. And so it's a huge tool that I think, you know, too often I think Headspace meditation has really been kind of pigeonholed into it being kind of out there, very spiritual, mm-hmm. religious based, but it's not. It's not, you know, akin to any one religion. Yeah, it has principles from Buddhism and whatnot that you know, where it was originated, but it very much can, you know, help you kind of hone in a way that's different from, let's say, praying or positive thinking that a lot of athletes, you know, currently use. That is super beneficial, man. And I every athlete I've introduced it to has seen a ton of impact from it. It was funny. I have a couple of quarterbacks from last year, Deshaun Watson and Mitch Trubisky, who both kind of were there that day when he came out. And like every single day I would walk up to the field and they're on their bench kind of meditating, which is pretty cool to see because nice. It's just not a
drill or they're,
yeah.
They're...
Well, they're doing this, like they're doing a 10 minute meditation. Like that's one of the things we challenge them with is every day doing 10 minutes before they train. And, you know, seeing them do that is pretty cool. It's kind of cool to see how much it's helping them kind of quiet the noise and really get focused in on what they have to do. Cause I think, you know, a lot of people that don't see these guys day to day don't realize how much they have going on in their lives, man, when it comes to like the endorsement stuff, the marketing, the, you know, team, kind of requests that they have, like to go speak at different high schools and all the stuff they have going on in their life, you know, family and, you know, husband, you know, girlfriends, wives, whatever. I think all that stuff kind of plays into their schedule that a lot of people don't see. And so getting them to focus in on the task at hand, whether it be the training session or the film study session or the game is super important and really what separates the good ones from the great ones. And so I just teaching them is I've seen such a huge benefit. And so Andy and I've developed a relationship working with a lot of the athletes over, you know, over time. And, yeah, it's been fun, man. I'm really, really excited to see kind of where Headspace can kind of take this field and how many more teams kind of start integrating it. Cause a lot of NBA teams are starting to use it now. A lot of NFL teams, a lot of athletes, are using that in their day to day kind of life and training. And it'll be exciting to see kind of how many more teams kind of pick that up.
Man, this shit fires me up. Have you had any conversations with Andy or thought of the fact that like you look at the way that like when a professional team or a professional athlete endorses a shoe or a supplement, that shoe or supplement just explodes in the marketplace. Have you had any conversations or thought about what the impact is going to be when something like this explodes in the marketplace?
Yeah. I mean, I think that's the cool part, man. This is why I love working with him and Headspace is just because they're so focused on just doing what's right and just helping athletes that they don't even think about that, which is like, you know, Nike is very much on the marketing side of like, well, how can we market this? And they, you know, and what I love so much about where they're at as a company is they're so, you know, early on in this that they just started like 2012, I think, is kind of, they just want to help as many people as possible. And then if people talk about
that's
it,
that's kind of what I mean. Like the impact that it will have on the world.
No, totally. I mean, I think that's something he says he kind of pitches himself every day. Cause I don't think they realize like how big of an impact this was going to have because it makes meditation relatable, you know, like even in like the simple things a couple of the guys, the quarterbacks were telling me when I was with them last about like just the art, the animation that they use helps you relate to it even in a way that you couldn't before. You know, a lot of times when I thought about meditation, it was like very ethereal, just very out there. I couldn't really kind of connect to it. And then, you know, the more he kind of shares with me that like, look, it's not about, I always thought I was just bad at meditating. I couldn't get my mind to quiet down. And what he was saying is like Buddhist monks can't get their mind to quiet down. It's in how you entertain those thoughts. You know, most people, he describes it as like watching cars pass on a freeway. Like instead of jumping in the car and riding that car for three exits, you just watch the thought go by and just let it pass and just keep letting your thoughts pass in a way that, you know, that's really what meditation is about. It's staying present, not getting too lost in any one thought that leads you to kind of, you know, being out of body, but staying present to your breath, staying kind of checking in with, you know, your body in a way that allows you just to watch those thoughts pass by like you watch cars pass on a freeway. Just really helps people, you know, understand and connect to meditation in a way that they, you know, I don't think have before, which is why they're having such great success.
Another thing that I know you guys have worked on with people is help using meditation or mindfulness to bring someone from a sympathetic to parasympathetic state. Can you talk about that a little?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think when you think about recovery, right, which is vital for every athlete, sleep is huge. And I mean, it is recovery, really. There's other elements to recovery, but sleep is the most important. And I think when you talk about that, if you know, really getting the nervous system, like getting people to switch from, you know, sympathetic, parasympathetic, when and back and forth. When you're talking about that, when you want them to be heightened for a performance and perform at a high level, but then when you need them to actually come down and recover and sleep, that for me is why I felt like when Headspace and meditation had the biggest impact with the athletes, was getting them in a place to where they had a huge day, a lot of training, a lot of excitement, a lot of things happening, a lot to think about, right? So especially in combine training, like these guys are so hyper-focused on what's everyone saying about them on in the media, you know, how fast they're going to run at the combine, what are teams going to think of them in their interviews, how will they end up like fitting, you know, selling themselves to kind of improve their draft stock, and where will they end up in the draft in April. Through that entire 3 months of me training them, that's all of those things are going through their mind, you know, and then yet you're asking them at night to kind of like wind it down and fall asleep. And so that's where I think meditation can have the largest impact the fastest, is getting people to kind of like get their mind, let their thoughts pass by, quiet down, develop a habit. One of the things that I've implemented with myself and then all the athletes I work with is have a pad of paper next to your bed to where you write down everything that's in your head, whether it's, oh, I got to call that, you know, guy tomorrow, I've got that interview, I've got to take my car to get an oil change, like all those thoughts that are happening, write them all down as they come in, then put on, you know, your meditation app Headspace for 10 minutes and then bring your, you know, just like, just lower the kind of, you know, energy that you're putting out, the, how quick your mind's racing, to kind of quiet all down, allow yourself to rest, is kind of really what I've seen the biggest impact on all the athletes I work with, because so many of them their brain operates at such a high frequency that getting them to chill out is one of the hardest things to do. And meditation has been the best tool to do that.
Hell yeah, man. I've probably talked about this 3-4 dozen times on the show. And I think this might be the most credible. You might be the most credible source yet. Talking about how all of these athletes use mindfulness. So thank you. I love it.
Yeah, my pleasure, man. Yeah.
So a quick Google search of your name, Ryan Flaherty Trainer, brought up an article of, I can't even remember who did it, maybe Men's Journal or something. And it talks about your quote unquote force number that has, you know, been a really popular topic when people are talking about you. And in that article, there was a mention of you making a bet with Johnny Manziel, which, for those of you who don't know, Johnny was one of the most successful college quarterbacks of all time. And he's still, I think he's back in the pros now. But you trained him getting ready for the combine. What was that bet?
Yeah. So, a lot of athletes, I think they're a lot faster than they really are. And most strength coaches that are listening to this right now will all laugh, because I know everybody's, you know, talked to an athlete and they're like, oh yeah, I'm a 4.3 guy. And then, you know, it was their uncle uncle test timed them in a park with no lines and they, you know, used a sundial. Full electronic time is much slower than what people think. And a lot of times anytime people watch the combine, they're always like, well, I thought that guy was way faster than that. And it's like, but very few, there's new, usually on any given year, 10, if not less, 4.3s at a combine with 300 athletes running. There's very few people who can run 4.3, let alone 4.4. And you know, 4.5 is a really fast time. Now, when you're talking about a hand time, based on the electronic timing system they use at the combine, the one I use, you know, my hand time to that electronic time is at least 0.15 to 0.2 of a second slower than my hand time. So it just puts in perspective of people that say, oh, I'm a 4.3 hand time guy. Usually they're a 4 or 5 electronic 40 guy. So I've had, you know, 10 flat 100 meter sprinters who have really hard time breaking in a fully electronic 4.5 on an electronic timing system. So it's a lot more difficult to do. And so most athletes come in with kind of like this inflated expectation of what they can actually run. And so I always laugh when we do a baseline test with all the athletes that I work with, and, you know, all of them always come in thinking they're much faster than they are. And so Johnny was very adamant that he was a 4.5 guy, and I knew he wasn't, but then we did a base strength.
How did you know he wasn't?
Well, so long story short, my background back in track and field, I set out and researched, was part of a team that researched kind of what makes somebody fast, right? And what we found was a lot of it had to do with kind of what we call mass-specific force, the amount of force you create over what your body weight is. So like if you imagine, if I were to have you get down and run a 40 right now, and you run a 40, let's say you run a 4.8, right? Mm-hmm. I'm just making a number up. If I threw a 40-pound weight vest on your back and had you run the exact, you know, 10 minutes later, run a 40 again, you'd most likely run a 5-something, right? Much slower time. Right. a lot of that is because of the mass specific force, the amount of force you create over what your body weight is. You're actually pushing your body mass down the field in order, you know, and that's how you run, right? You're creating force to the ground, and based on you moving that mass of, you know, forward, it's people know what I'm talking about. Anyways, right. We have a way to test that. So through force plates, force plate treadmill, I can test what your mass specific force is, and then in turn predict how fast you run.
And so you had seen him.
I tested him. I took him through the full assessment. Yeah, I took him through a full assessment, and then we were able to. I could then take that and predict. All right, his at his top speed, he's able to, you know, reach X mile per hour, X velocity, or I could say, you know, he's going to run this split for his 20 to 40 yard split. And based on that number, I can then figure out, you know, what his 40 yard dash time is based on a bunch of data that I've collected over the years. And so I was able to see, like, he's going to run in the high force, like low 4.8s, so high 4.8s around that range. And, you know, he was like, you're full of shit. Like, there's no way I'm going to run that slow. Like, you're crazy. Like, there's no way. And I'm like, I'll bet you. And he was like, name it. And so I bet him $2,000 that he'd run over a 4.7. He thought he was for sure going to run a 4.5, and, you know, ended up running a 4.79 or whatever it was, and end up winning money on him, but off of him. But I do that with a lot of athletes. And now at this point, though, the word spread, so they don't like bet. They don't bet me anymore. Yeah, it really is. Especially with the really, really cocky ones who think really have feel like they're faster than they are. But anyways, yeah. So was able to take some money off of him, and he still hasn't paid me for that, which need to collect.
Oh, that's amazing. So, okay. So the force number is essentially force divided by your body weight. Is that the nuts and bolts of it?
Well, so, okay. So yeah, need to clarify that. So long story short, I sold my IP to Nike, and through, because of that, the algorithm and the data set that they acquire to use in their apps and with the athletes that they train, I can't divulge like exactly what the algorithm is. And then that article, I talked to our author about that, but he didn't kind of state that I was withholding several key components of the algorithm so Nike wouldn't like back out of the deal, because at the moment I was in the negotiation process with them and whatnot. Anyways, I very much simplified what it is. The way we improve that force number, though, is through a very specific training methodology, which is utilizing a hex bar deadlift and concentric only strength training. What we do know is that a lot of what makes somebody faster is their strength to weight ratio. So what happens a lot of times when athletes improve their strength is they also increase their muscle mass. However, for every pound of increase of muscle mass, it has an effect on how fast somebody is, right? So if you, you know, increase your strength and 1 RM increase across the board, but you also add 25 pounds of lean muscle mass, you go from 220 to 225. There's a very good chance your speed is not going to improve,
right?
Even though you've gotten a lot stronger, right? And most strength training is very much targeted at increasing strength, but at the same rate, increasing muscle mass. The key, though, is stressing the nervous system to recruit larger motors to improve your strength, but not add any muscle mass. And it's a technique I've used with a lot of athletes I work with, a lot of distance runners I train, is to, you know, stride length is a product of mass, how much force you create over what your body mass is. Mm-hmm. Now there's a lot of other things that go into that. There's you know, technique and whatnot. But if you take a sample group of people, of runners who are all elite, let's say like the top 10 sprinters in the world, and you were then, and all of them have a very, you know, similar level of sprint mechanics to where there's very little wasted movement, and they're creating the most amount of force to the ground as they possibly can in the quickest way, so fastest rate of force, most increase, you know, creating the most mass specific force. If you take that small sample and you test them, then you'll be able to see kind of the differences in strength to weight ratio from the fastest athlete to the slowest. If you took a wide range of a group of people, you know, an 11-year-old Pop Warner athlete, a NCAA sprinter, and a high school distance runner, you know, it would be, you're going to see differences, but it's going to be harder because there's so much other things they can improve, right? There's like mechanical issues they struggle with. So you, based on the force number, we can predict how fast you can run, but it may mean you may need to improve, you know, different mechanical issues. Mm-hmm. There's you know, could be some strength issues, you know, imbalances you have, asymmetries. And also there's another element of, which is rate of force, that you also have to focus on. And a lot of people focus on those through plyometrics, but there's specific ways that I do that, that I've tested over the years that, I've honed in on it as being the best ways to improve an athlete's explosiveness and speed, over other traditional strength training methodologies.
Oh man, I have so many questions. So I think you may have already said this, but just in case, just to highlight this, for those listening, he's talking about, he said concentric only. So he's talking about a hex bar deadlift. You might know it as a trap bar deadlift. And he's talking about standing up with the weight and then dropping it from the top. That's a concentric only rep. Do you do that? So it makes perfect sense for me to do that with a distance athlete. Are you doing that with, say, football players or like your sprinters?
Yes.
Okay. Why?
Yeah.
Or, well, not why. I hear you when you're talking about body weight. I guess I'm just, especially with someone like a football player, I think of it as like there's so many other factors that are in play that.
Totally. There are.
Seems like so, there wouldn't be enough volume to really add a significant amount of weight to those guys. But what are you seeing?
For sure. So everything comes down to specificity, right? So like what I'm targeting with an athlete when I work with them is making them faster, right? There absolutely is elements in my training which are focused on imbalance, asymmetry, injury prevention, balance, posture, flexibility, all of the things that like a strength coach would kind of take into account working with an athlete that works in three different planes of motion, right? So like, right. I'm not just looking at a linear athlete all the time, like in treating a football player like they're a track and field sprinter. However, there's certain moments in time when I do, like for example, combine training, right? So like a lot of the athletes that I have for those 8 weeks, you know, like a defensive back who needs to run a 4.4 in order for him to stay in the first round and get drafted in the first round, it's really important that the focus shifts from, yeah, we have the rest of the year to focus on injury prevention and kind of like the training a well-rounded athlete to be able to take on, the rigors of a full season, right, that require way more than just concentric, hex bar deadlifting. But when the time of the year focuses really tightly on speed, what I'm trying to do is eliminate all of the things, in a training program that may not lead to that result. So if the goal is just making someone run a faster 40-yard dash, I'm probably not going to have them do a ton of deep back squatting or a ton of Olympic lifting, mm-hmm, because my target is actually to improve their strength to weight ratio. I'm trying to train them neuromuscularly. I'm trying to get them to recruit motor units in a way that in the fastest way possible in 6 weeks that will lead to the greatest result in the shortest amount of time. So I'm trying to basically cut off all the fat of a training plan in 6 weeks to get them just to run as fast as freaking possibly. Yeah. No, totally. Exactly. Which, part of it is actually nutrition. So I consult with a lot of different strength coaches, a lot of different professional teams. Like, one of them that I worked with the longest is Buddy Morris, who's the Arizona Cardinals strength coach. And Buddy and I have this conversation all the time. I think what gets taken out of context a little bit is like, all that guy does is hex bar deadlift, but that's not the case at all. It depends on kind of who the athlete is individually, what their goal is, what they're trying to do. Like, I was brought in to work with one of our Nike athletes, Kobe Bryant, towards the end of his career. His vertical jump and his speed had really diminished over the course of his career because the way he was training his body was just maintenance, just trying to stay healthy, not get injured. He was overcoming a really, bad Achilles injury and surgery. And so his training program for himself was very much very light, very functional, very focused on just staying healthy. The problem was he lost all of his explosiveness and he lost his speed, and that's what he wanted to get back. And so I had to show him, look, these are the elements of your training that you've left out that really can help you get faster and more explosive really fast if we just implement them back in. Some of it's gonna be a a neural response, but others is, you're trying to recruit motor units. You're trying to, shift the body from very low resistance, low level of, you're looking for adaptation to very high, stresses. So you're looking for heavy weight, low reps, lots of recovery. And then also on the rate of force side, you're looking for trying to train the body cyclically. So you're looking for how much can you teach the body to relax and explode and throw your body, like whether through a plyometric, an assisted plyometric. So if you're trying to retrain rate of force, or if you're trying to train the body to get as strong as possible without adding any lean muscle mass, there's little levers you can pull that have the greatest result in the shortest amount of time. And that's what I'm focused on. Now, if I was then given the strength job at for an NFL team, it would shift because my goal and the results I'm targeting are different for that team environment for a long season. It's not targeted at like, how can I make every guy run the fastest 40 when that's not really going to help us win more football games. So it always just kind of shifts to like who I'm working with and kind of the goal you're targeting. But we still do, like, you know, Buddy has trained throughout his year in his programming, a heavy dose of hex bar deadlifts to focus on, you know, recruiting those larger motivates and to get his athletes faster in the off season to really lead into the summer, before he kind of shifts back into more of a football, you know, in season kind of maintenance training program.
Oh man, this is phenomenal. So I want to backtrack for a second and help synthesize something that you mentioned, and correct me if I'm wrong here, but you were talking about you're only doing concentric because you're very clear about the metric that you're trying to improve, and you know that like a full repetition, you know, with an eccentric and what was the middle phase?
Isometric.
Isometric phase is not going to improve your sprint speed as much. So one of the things that eccentric training can do is it improves tendon and ligament function. It
elasticity, improves
connective tissue function, right?
Absolutely.
Which is super important when you're talking about injury prevention and muscle gain and all of those types of things, which are usually very important for athletes. But you've gotten very, very clear about what is most important to improve in this short period of time, and you're just focusing on that.
Correct.
I love it.
Yeah. Amazing. And then now when I'm working with like some of my quarterbacks, right? So like doing off season training. So this summer, like, you know, Marcus Mariota or something, you know, a big tool for him as a quarterback is speed. So we always want to kind of, you know, throughout his training program. So if I have him for 8 weeks this off season, starting in mid June all the way to August 1st, you know, he's going to have elements of, you know, sprint training. So we're going to work on acceleration. We're going to work on max velocity in the weight room, where we are going to target, you know, improving his strength to weight ratio and increasing, trying to recruit as many large motivants as possible for him doing that. We're going to do a lot of plyometrics, but then we're also going to sprinkle in throughout the programming in different phases, intervention, stabilization, you know, VMO, glute med, work. We're going to do a ton of, you know, we're going to do a lot of plyos for him. Like, there's going to be a lot of different things we're going to do. We're going to train him in all different planes of motion. So, and movement. So there's going to be a lot of elements for him in his training plan that will integrate the speed training that we did for the combine, but it won't be like the main focus of the program. Right. So it's, there's ways to sprinkle it in. And there's also, you know, that's why I love working with track and field athletes, because that's really all I do. You know, like an athlete like Devin Allen, who is one of our US hurdlers who played football at Oregon, but now he's focusing on track and field. Like, all we do is really focus on improving his speed, which is what I have the most fun doing. That's really what my specialty is, I would say. That's my passion really lies in helping, you know, push the limits of human performance and how fast athletes can run. But when you're working with other athletes, there's a lot of other stresses on the body that you have to take into account for over a long period of time and a long season that aren't just about increasing the strength, the athlete's strength to weight ratio.
Right. I mean, this is by far like the most high level way to go about programming for an athlete. What most people do is they learn a bunch of tactics and gain a bunch of tools, and then they just train athletes in everything at the same time, rather than getting very clear about what a specific athlete needs. And that's exactly what you're doing. You're figuring out exactly what each person needs and training them in that way. I love it.
Yeah. Why? Yeah. And one of the things I've looked at too, man, just to like go back on, is people are always like, well, do you, you know, how do you not have your athletes squat, or how do you have your athletes not Olympic lift? And I think what I've looked at and what I've researched is, so I work with a lot of Olympic lifting coaches, and back when I was with the Olympic committee, a lot of what we would do is kind of like spreading ideas and methodologies throughout kind of all different sports, right? Sharing ideas from, you know, Olympic weightlifting to track and field to bat, like all over the place. And one of the things we saw was that I was working with the Philippine Olympic Committee and working with their strength, their Olympic lifting coach, and he implemented my deadlift protocol for 4 weeks over the course of a month. And when they went back to go test their Olympic lifts, they all had PR'd.
No shit.
Yeah, because, well, think about it, man. Like, everything is about getting the bar away from the ground, right? So if you increase your 1 RM in your deadlift, naturally kind of your Olympic lifts, because if you maintain really good technique, your Olympic lifts are going to improve as well. So I think that's where a lot of it comes down to kind of, what are you looking to get from the athlete? Because if you talk to a lot of Olympic coaches, Olympic lifting coaches, they would say, man, it takes me 2 years to teach my Olympic lifters proper technique for Olympic lifting. And I see high school kids doing Olympic lifts for football. Mm-hmm. They don't, a lot of Olympic lifting coaches don't understand it. And when you talk to somebody like Buddy Morris, who's been in the strength and conditioning field for, you know, 40 years, his whole thing is, we first initiated, you know, incorporating Olympic lifting into football, American football, purely because we were looking for an Olympic lifting feeder system. We were looking to, if a kid comes out of college and doesn't go to the NFL, but he has 4 years of Olympic lifting experience, that's a great way for him to feed into the Olympic lifting program. What we've lost sight of, though, is that is the initiation of what, why Olympic lifting ended up in football to start with, and in college sports to start with. It wasn't because it was the best method to get an athlete to improve the best. It was actually to feed to our Olympic lifting system. Now, that's probably really controversial. A lot of people would be like, you know, this guy's an idiot. But I think it's just important to share. I enjoy doing Olympic lifting personally. I really do. But when it comes to an athlete and teaching them a movement that's going to help them improve on the field, I'm always looking at, like, man, how do I take away all the learning curve from the weight room? How do I take away kind of all the time spent on mastering a movement when I can get the most bang for my buck in the shortest amount of time from something else that still improves all those other things too? You know, like, I think I'm always trying to edit to amplify. I'm always looking at ways to lessen the volume, the load, and still getting the same result. Like, if I could get that in 10 minutes of strength training for an athlete, I'll do it. And that's, I think, what I'm always looking for. And we're never going to reach the finish lines. I'm just constantly trying to learn and adapt to new information, new research, and test it and, you know, conduct small experiments over time to where, you know, I'm trying to stay, you know, adapting and evolving as more research comes to light. But that's the tough part, man. It's like, there's not a ton of research to point us in the direction of, like, hey, man, this is the best way to do 20 it.
20 or 30 years behind, right?
It is. Yeah. And it's on us as coaches to kind of experiment, share ideas, you know, test it. If it works, great. If it doesn't, it doesn't. But I think, I'm not trying to be the expert in any of this, really. I mean, if I'm still doing hex bar deadlifting 5 years from now, I'm not doing my, like, I really hope we're not still doing that. Like, I hope there's other ways, modes to, you know, methods to get us, there without kind of putting all that strain on the spine and the back and the pelvis. So I think it's just one of those things where, you know, I'm just trying to constantly adapt and not stay stagnant. But I think we get too caught up in kind of, you know, sticking to a premise of, like, Olympic lifting, and that's what we stand for, you know, instead of, like, what's best for the athlete.
So I know you tested a ton of different movements over the years, and you were even in, like, with the USA track and field, y'all were even in you did some very specific research. Why, from a physiological standpoint, do you think the hex bar deadlift correlates to force production most, as opposed to something like, say, even like a clean pull?
Sure.
Something, because, you know, what most people would call an explosive movement.
Yeah, absolutely. I think there's validation for both. I think there's, you know, so we're both looking at very similar things, right? When you're talking about, when I'm looking at the hex bar deadlift, I'm not looking to improve rate of force. I'm looking to recruit as much of the body's large motor units as possible to get the athlete to understand how to recruit those motor units that you use when you full speed sprint. How do you recruit those in a way in the weight room that allows your body to have that reservoir to tap into when you need it the most? Also, because of the handles of being on the side of the body, it allows you, you create more vertical force, which at your top speed and max velocity is what you're creating when you're running. And instead of the bar being on the front side of your body, like in a clean or a deadlift, to where it's much more posterior chain focused, the handles on the side of the body allow your body to kind of get much more balanced, and use, you know, 80-something% of your skeletal muscle to kind of get that bar, to get the bar up, in a way that's going to translate the best to vertical, creating vertical force when you sprint.
Love it, man. So you work with maybe more high level athletes than anyone I've ever talked to. Who was the first really big athlete you worked with? And was there ever a moment where you thought, holy shit, how did I get here?
Yeah, I still ask myself that all the time. Man, the first one was Andrew Luck, actually, was the first one I worked with that was the first, like, number one pick I had that I did not know if I was ready to kind of deal with an athlete that, at that level. Also, too, you just don't think, I don't think a lot of trainers probably feel like, you know, am I ready? Am I the right person for this job? And you know, I think it just, when you're ready, I think you know, and I think a lot of athletes will kind of validate that for you. If you got a lot of athletes coming back to you or seeking you out, I think it's because they, you know, recognize the results you get with either teammates of theirs or people they know. But he was probably the first athlete where I was like, man, am I in over my head here? Right. And he, you know, he was like the consensus number one pick, and all I could do was kind of mess it up. I couldn't really help him improve. And he wasn't like, he was going from like, you know, it was a third round pick and there's a lot of room for improvement. If like, the only way he wasn't going number one is if he got injured. So I think my approach at that time was just, I was very conservative in looking at like, how do I just not get this guy injured and help him just get to, you know, the NFL in the best, you know, way. Now looking back, I wish I would have kind of been a little bit more aggressive. Obviously, like you see now, I haven't worked with him since the combine, and you kind of see now the injuries have added up for him, and the shoulder injuries and whatnot, which kind of shines a light on. Yeah, probably. I don't know. You can blame it on me. I think you know, it just shines a light for me that trust what's right and trust, you know, your training and your experience that you're going to be able to get the job done. And also too, I think one thing I pride myself on is being open enough to know, like I'm not strong in certain areas, you know, when it comes to manual therapy or, you know, physical therapy or other aspects of training, that I bring in other experts that I know or people that I think are phenomenal what they do to help the athlete as well. And being open enough to say, hey, this is not a super, you know, strong point for me, so I'm going to bring in other people who I think are really good at it, and being open enough to kind of create that team that, really at the end of the day is just always going to benefit the athlete the most.
So you're kind of known as the savant of speed, and I'm not sure if I don't know if that started before the Tim Ferriss show or not, but now you're definitely known as the savant of speed. what specifically might a track workout look for an athlete other than a track athlete, you know, a football player, yeah, tennis player, sure, something like that?
Yeah. I mean, what people don't like, when you look at track and field, right, you look at the athletes that are in the 100 meter dash, 200 meter dash, look at their bodies. I mean, they are some of the top looking athletes in the world. And what people don't realize is that their training isn't super over the top intense. I think, you know, for my biggest, one of my eye opening moments was when I got a chance to kind of go watch Jamaicans run back when I was like 21 years old, and seeing Usain Bolt, you know, and Safa Powell and those guys train, you know, after every 100 meter sprint they ran in training or 80 meter sprint they ran in training, they took 10 minutes in between every rep to rest and recover to get back to 100% and, you know, allow their phosphine pools to regenerate around 10, anywhere between 5 and 10 minutes recovering between each rep to allow them to run again at 100% full speed, right? Because they're trying to train their neuromuscular system and their neuromuscular coordination to be able to improve and run really fast. When you start running slower and slower times because you're tired, your body, you're not training the same energy system and you're not training your neuromuscular, your coordination isn't the same as it is when you're at 100%. So it's really important to train at 100% as much as possible as a track and field athlete. And I think that's what most track, you know, workouts look like, is it's, you know, 4 to 8 reps of, let's say, a flying 20 meter sprint where you get up to speed for 20 meters and then you time from 20 to 40 meters. And that flying 20, you know, you'll run that in 2.4 seconds and then you'll take 5 to 10 minute recovery in between each sprint. You'll do that anywhere between 4 and 8 reps. That's what a track workout looks like. And it's funny because every football player I put that through first, they're like, man, this workout's going to be easy. It's only 4 reps. It's like, yeah, just talk to me tomorrow. And then the next day, you know, they can barely walk because their hamstrings are so, you know, sore and, you know, their body's so sore from that workout because it's takes such a toll on the body running that with that intense, you know, with that much effort and that intensity, over and over again, that it, you know, the changes in the body are pretty drastic, and not a lot of people kind of use that type of training, in with the general population. I think there's a lot of, I think there's a lot of reasons we should actually.
Absolutely. And I think the biggest take home message for most people listening to this is that rest period. I've seen so many people try to do speed work almost like as an EMOM, you know, like an every minute on minute. And they're really getting nothing done. They're hanging out in a moderate intensity state and they think they're working speed and they're really working nothing.
Exactly. And what I do with my athletes is I'll have them run their, you know, 100% full speed, their fastest, you know, 40 yard sprint, let's say it's 4.7 seconds, right? Mm-hmm. every workout we'll run, I'll have them run within 5% of that sprint. So if it's 4.7 seconds, let's say they're 95% of that is 4.79 or 4.82 seconds or whatever. And I'll make them run under that time every time with recovery. And if they run over, their workout's over. So some athletes will run 3 sprints, some others will run 8, depending on their, you know, their recovery and how well they're feeling that day. And then based on that, that's how long the workout will be. But we're always training within 5% of their PR, right. And that will ensure that we're training the right energy system, the right type of neuromuscular coordination that you're looking to get out of that workout in a way that gives you the greatest improvement without kind of overtraining.
Oh, that's great. So I have a friend, and this I'm asking this because I think it applies to so many people as we get older. I've got a friend who is, he was a really, really great athlete in high school. He's still super strong. So he does, you know, a lot of just kind of regular strength and conditioning. He's about 35 years old and he was playing flag football the other day and tore the shit out of it. Actually, he tore his patellar tendon.
Oh yeah, that's a tough injury.
I feel like, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I feel like part of the problem, because I see this all the time with older guys that are still in the gym doing something with their knees, they're continuing to get really, really strong without, but it's all in the sagittal plane, right? They're just going forward and back. They're going up and down. They have no lateral movement. So when they go play soccer or basketball or football, they're just at a really high risk of injury.
Is that
what you see? And if so, what are some ways that people can prevent this from happening? Because, you know, a lot of people want to play those types of sports and not get injured.
100%. I mean, that's where it comes into kind of that, you know, training similar energy systems or similar, you know, percentage of effort with whatever you're going to go get after, right? So that specificity to your training in the activities you want to do. You know, a lot of times what you'll see is, a lot of times knee injuries are due to either overuse or they're from just years and years of tearing down. And then you go out and you maximally sprint for the first time in a year and something blows, right? Mm-hmm. So I think it's if you're not going to undertake something where you're going to full speed sprint or full speed cut, is train that way. Go out and full speed sprint, full speed cut, or build up from, 70% of that to 80% to 90% over a period of time to where you so many of us mentally are 21 years old, but physically we're 40 years old. I think that's the problem, is that we think we can call up back on that and our body's naturally going to respond when it just doesn't. So I think, if you're going to, you're going to play basketball every weekend, like really start training yourself in a way where you start doing those, shuffling, the change of direction, lateral movements to linear movement, and start asking your body to respond faster and faster over the course of time to start developing that, and get specific to what you're doing. If you're changing direction, you're going lateral, shuffle to sprint, back pedal to sprint, like start doing that more incorporated in your workouts and your training, other than just going out and playing the sport, I think we'll start to have, a positive benefit. But yeah, man, I think the biggest issue is just people just thinking their body's, 10 years younger than it is and not kind of, training it in a way that it's going to respond well.
Do you think 2 weeks, like a 2 week prep period, would clear up a huge percentage of those injuries?
Yeah, 100. Yes, absolutely. I think a lot. I think a 15-minute dynamic warm-up would clear up a lot of those injuries. I think a lot of it just has to do with us not prepping the body for the stress we're about to put it under in a positive way. I mean, I can't tell you how many times. Like, so I started training a couple Nike CrossFit athletes a year ago, and I had not really done a lot of CrossFitting myself. So if I was gonna program for them, I knew I needed to put myself under that stress to get a feel for what it felt like to go through some of the training they go through in order for me to give right programming for them, So I did. I started going to CrossFit and training that way to get a feel for it. And, I can't tell you how many times knowing what I know, walked into class for a little bit late and just jumped into the workout, and knowing like, oh man, I could absolutely like injure myself doing this right now, but I know better. But it's tough to do. You just have to be disciplined in that way. As they say, it's better, you either feel the pain of discipline or the pain of regret. And I think too often people feel that pain of regret because they don't have that discipline to kind of know, all right, even though I'm going to be really late, I'm just going to finish this 10-minute warm-up real quick to prepare myself to go into that, session. And I think that can be something that will help a lot of people out.
Tell me a little more about your experience doing CrossFit. What was it like?
It's fun, man. I mean, I think it was really surprising for me. One, I think there's some room to be made up in the programming. I think there's some positives and some things that I think can be improved here and there, but I think there's a lot of people pushing it forward. I think mm-hmm. it you know, I love the community aspect of it. I love the kind of structure of the workouts, the competitive nature of training next to the person next to you and trying to, you know, better yourself and better, you know, beat the guy next to you. But also, I think it's great. I mean, I think like I tell people all the time, if it's getting you moving and off the couch, it's, you know, go for it. That's better than doing nothing. So I think it's great. I think there's, like I said, I think as CrossFit has its time in the sun longer and longer, I think there's going to be, it's going to draw better and better coaches. And I think initially what was the problem is, you know, somebody who hadn't worked out in a long time going into a gym and learning, you know, pretty quickly, they start to, you know, they're doing snatches or whatever. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they haven't been taught the proper, you know, sequence and train the movement enough to get better at it or protect themselves from injury.
Right. They can't pick up a suitcase off the floor, much less.
Exactly. You know, and yeah. And then in football, you know, in the athletes I train, most of the injuries occur when they're fatigued. So in CrossFit, the point of the workout is to fatigue you, and then you're asking them to do a movement they're not used to, and, mm-hmm. and through that fatigue they get injured. So I think it's just more of like, as that evolves, I think it's going to get better and better. But no, I'm a fan, man. I'm a fan of it.
So if you were the head of CrossFit programming, if that's even a thing, what kind of changes might you make?
Man, good question. I think more it would be in monitoring load. I think in understanding kind of like from day to day, if someone can't come to your box 5 days in a row, you got to understand the effect of that load over the course of that week on their body and how they're going to respond. Mm-hmm. You know, if I think individualizing programming a little bit more, if you can, if people who come to the box more often than others, knowing, hey, this guy's going to come 5 days in a row. Here's the program he's on instead of it just being, hey, here's the workout of the day. Because I think what we don't realize is like the effect of over the course of that week, that how that impact that load and the potential of movement day to day of how that's going to affect that workout from Monday to Tuesday. You know, like a lot of times what I found is I talked to the coaches of the box I was going to where the strength focus on that day would be a deadlift. And then we would go into a WOD that would incorporate deadlifts. And it's like, mm-hmm. you know, we're already exhausting that movement in the strength session. And I'm going into a WOD that's going to ask me to do 60 deadlifts. And you know, 90% of the people in here's backs are going to be blown out by the end of this workout.
Right.
So I think looking at the structuring your training in a way where the strength portion maybe focuses on a different, you know, element of movement than the WOD does in order to help people kind of like not exhaust that, you know, that your body in that way, I guess that would help, you know, cause like I said, most injuries occur when you're fatigued. But yeah, I think there's just the understanding of load and kind of using more math modeling to understand what the impact of that load over the course of the week.
So I can hear a lot of people, or I would assume a lot of people that heard what you just said about individualizing programming, kind of complaining that they have too many members to actually implement that. And I'm gonna call bullshit on that because I've seen strength and conditioning coaches with literally hundreds of athletes produce very high level individualized programming. And it doesn't mean every single person is on a completely different program. It could just mean people have different variations of the main program. It could mean that people have specific mobility that they're working on. I think the take home message here is put more thought into how your programming, like the effect that your programming is having on your on their bodies, on your members' bodies, and don't get stuck in the focus of like, well, how can I break these people down and just trying to like leave them in a pool of sweat like so many people do. So I really love that advice.
Yeah, Ryan, yeah, my pleasure. I think just triggering. No. I think in programming too. Last point I would just make is just in your programming, just have little triggers where if somebody comes in and the day before did this workout or this movement, that the next day they would naturally get pushed into this training plan instead of it being something where you have to each person individualize, you know, a month long training plan for. You just have triggers where, you know, based on the day before's workout or training, this is what it would trigger for the next day. And if you didn't come for 2 days, then you could naturally just jump back into the workout of the day. That might just help. But I think just load monitoring in whatever way you can, just start looking at that may have a big impact on your gym in general.
Love it, man. And yeah, that might even be just like paying more attention to who's been coming more often and just having them go a little lighter if they've gone 100%. 4 days in a row. So Ryan, I know you're up against time, man. Keep up with you and find out more about what you got going on?
Yeah, man. We're actually launching the Nike Training Podcast this summer. And so we're going to be launching that. So that's the place people can check us out. My Instagram, Ryan at Ryan J Flaherty. You can find me there, message me there. If you guys have questions, just reach out. But yeah, man, I appreciate you having me on.
Dude, this was so good. Thank you so much, man.
Thanks, Mike. Appreciate it.
Later.
This episode is finished, but your training journey continues. Head over to brutestrengthtraining.com/SSW and grab your free pack of 32 accessory workouts that you can incorporate into your training and start improving your strength immediately. That's brutestrengthtraining.com/SSW.